among the top contributors to the country's slower growth in the second quarter was the manufacturing sector. Household consumption expenditure also took a hit, slumping 1% quarter on quarter on the back of elevated inflation.
Let's talk about the country's growth story with Olivia Limpeau, Destilleria Limtuaco's chairman and CEO. And we'll be joined later by Federico Macaranas, Management Association of the Philippines Education Committee Chair. Oliv, so happy to have you here in the studio.
Thank you, Salve.
So not a lot of companies can boast of a 117-year history. Yeah. Wow. So you're really a part of the Philippine culture, right?
Yes.
How have you fared? How is it doing financially now? COVID is over, hopefully.
Luckily for us, during the COVID, we were able to pivot to sanitizer alcohol, so we survived. And now we are, of course, back to our usual business, which is the liquor business. And we're doing okay. We're doing good. And we're looking forward to our O&D sales, right? Because, you know, for liquor, our peak season is October, November, December. So we're
party
preparing
time.
For that. Yes, party time. And of course, that's when people get their bonuses. So it's when it's really party season and time for revelry and celebrations.
Now, for 2023, it's expected that the alcoholic drink industry is going to rake in $620 billion? In Asia, but of course there are still, are you still seeing some headwinds and challenges ahead?
Well, there's always opportunities and challenges for any industry, and we're happy to hear about this news about the growth of spirits in Asia. And if you are an exporter, of course, you can take advantage of that. We are one of the top exporters of spirits in the Philippines, and we are always looking for new markets where we can bring our products to and promote them. And of course, in the Philippines, we do have a very young population. And so with our population growth, there is always opportunities for increasing our revenues and improving our offering.
And that's something I'm really curious about. For 170 years, you've survived and thrived. Mostly, I'm assuming it's innovation all throughout those years. How do you continually innovate to catch up with trends, with what your market likes?
Well, I think really you have to have an understanding of the market. You have to know when to let go of certain brands, when to take risk on new trends, right? But there's always that risk. You know, you don't really have a magic ball right in front of you. So what happens is you try, if it works, then you continue. If you feel that sometimes brands also age with the market, right? So you try to also keep your brands relevant to the younger generation. So it's really a generational thing. But sometimes there are brands that really young people don't want. So you know that it will die with the older generation, right? But then you also have brands that are timeless. So I think it's a product of marketing that you're able to keep it relevant to the younger generation. So it really depends on how the company markets its brands and takes care of its brands, and also are conscious about not making them age.
Yeah.
You know, I think it's only people that age, but maybe brands, if you don't, I think maybe.
We don't age. Sorry, we don't age.
Yes, I think
Let's
you
keep
have
it
to.
That. Yeah, we don't.
Yeah, so I think it's important that we really take care of the brands. Mm. Like we take care of ourselves. Yeah. We practice maintenance, so we age gracefully, right? And for brands, it's the nice thing is that they don't really get wrinkles like humans, right? So you can extend the life of brands more than people. Yeah, so
this is a marked difference from, because you're the first lady, you're the first woman in the family who has led the Destilleria Limtuaco in 170 years, right?
Yes.
Is this a very different approach?
Well, I think yes.
Called, you know, I would love. I've always asked you if it's you're called the Iron Lady, whether taming or inciting animal spirits in Asia. That's a great job description.
Yes, yes. I think yes, there is a difference in the way a woman would would manage a distillery, whereas a man would also, right? Mm-hmm. So there are, I think in terms of innovation, a woman will take things that interest her. Mm-hmm. So I think that's what I was able to bring to the company, is innovating drinks that I was interested in, like, and then also being nationalistic, I wanted to promote Philippine products and use Philippine produce to create these products. And then, of course, I put in a bit of my interest, like fashion and beauty. So I try to make our packaging beautiful and very appealing and attractive, you know. So I think, and of course, in terms of management, there's also a difference. I think women are a bit more nurturing and more motherly in their management style and approach. So there are pros and cons, really. Whereas a man, they say, you know, would go straight to the point, you know, I don't care who I, you know, if I hit this person, I get rid of this person. But, you know, women will have more considerations to think about before they make a decision. That's why sometimes we are, they say that we're slow in decision making. I think not that we're really slow, but we're just, we just look at things, many things before we make a decision, because we are a bit more sometimes emotional, mm-hmm. you know, more motherly. So there are differences.
Which leads me to actually my question on, when we were talking about how to lead the industry forward as well, not just maybe the distillery, but also the manufacturing sector as a
yes.
whole, that there's such a huge skills mismatch. And as a mother, I mean,
yes.
if this is your management style, you're trying to make sure that everybody is doing the right thing in the right place. And you've done a certain kind of innovation that's very different from what other people are doing.
Yeah, so again, as a mother, right? So we are used to teaching our children. So the first teacher of a child is a mother, right? So
yes.
So I think that's innate in women to teach. Mm-hmm. And this mismatch, I feel, is very important for all industries. Mm-hmm. And so what we did is that instead of waiting for the educators to come up with all these training courses or curriculum that will address the needs of industry, we figured that maybe we were taking it the wrong, it was the wrong approach, waiting for them to do it. Mm-hmm. And so we decided that we would initiate it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So we would be involved in the drafting of competency standards for a certain course. In this case, my pilot course is the salesmanship course.
We didn't learn that in college, did
no.
you?
No. Yeah, because there's no such course in college, right?
Yeah,
yeah. So it's something that I'm very passionate about, because I know that a lot of salespeople end up in the position, mm-hmm. not because they wanted to, but because it was the only position offered to them. And so what we did was to come up with the competency standards, mm-hmm. and we had it approved by the TESDA,
mm-hmm.
and now it's on the TESDA website, and
everybody could use.
Yes, everybody could just go to the website, download the competency standard, and create their own curriculum, which they can offer in their learning institutions or in their whatever training courses, mm-hmm. right? So that was the first step that we took, and that is also in line with the management educators workshop,
Professor,
right?
Yeah. Welcome to the show. Thank you very much for joining us. The bigger picture now, talking about jobs mismatch. In the case of Distillery Limpuaco, they had to create their own course. But in resolving this bigger issue in the country, where should it start? Should it start from schools? Should it start from companies doing the same thing? Or should it be the government mapping this out?
Well, actually, industry knows what it needs.
Mm-hmm.
The professors and the government hardly know what industries need. Why? Because things are moving so fast. What you needed last month, you may not need tomorrow.
Mm-hmm.
So it is industry that must be approaching the problem from their own point of view. And Olive did that beautifully.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, in Iloilo, where we had this management educators workshop, she was lauded by no less than the president of the Management Association,
mm-hmm.
because it addresses the very issue. How fast can industry adjust when it is waiting for the teachers to find out what
right.
industry
mm-hmm.
needs?
Mm-hmm. That
makes
so much sense.
So the best is corporate university.
Uh-huh.
Enterprise-based institutions that help themselves mm-hmm. with the help of educators.
Mm-hmm.
And what Olive did was exactly what we will be prototyping.
will the Management Association of the Philippines take this seriously? Like, if all of the people in MAP create their own competency assessments and
the standards and then the curriculum and then the assessment afterwards.
Olive was telling us there are more than 1,374
skills needed by this country, by our country, right?
And but that's going to change even because AI and so many other things happening.
And only six competency skills have been so far defined by TESDA for this new and emerging needs of the country. So we must scale up right away through industry-academic partnership.
No wonder hiring is such a big problem.
Yes, actually. So the salesmanship course that the competency standard for that addresses only six of the 1,391. So imagine there is still 1,385 skills that we still need to address, right? And I think what's important is everybody in the private sector can help the government by looking into their industries and really thinking, what is it that I need? And where can I help?
Yeah.
Because I don't think you can expect the government to do it because they're not the industry. They're not also the educators, right?
Maybe not as fast, but what can the government do? What should the government be doing right now to catch up?
They should provide incentives so that the industry and academe can partner very quickly. For example, we need some laboratories for some of your products, and maybe with the DOST around, it could help make changes in existing labs so that if you are testing certain new things, they'll be easily available to you.
But this is a long game.
Well, it depends, because Olive's own alcohol conversion from beverage to sanitizer is proof that it can be done quickly.
It can be.
You need the management skills and, of course, the resolve of all players to fast-track whatever you need.
Yeah, but I was thinking about developing the modules, starting attracting the right students to the right courses and then training them for 2 years, 3 years, 4 years before you can actually hire these people.
That's why we need to change the mindset of not only the educators but also the students. We must be agile. Everyone must be quick. If you're not quick enough, then you lose the game. So it's not just industry being quick, but the educators and the students being quick at grasping opportunities. And if that's the message, then everyone will be not in a sprint, but in a marathon. And that marathon would produce winners along the way. And hopefully, we choose the right industries where we can make a great difference in job creation and value creation for the country. Soon, we'll be known as a very agile country responding to challenges.
And hopefully, all higher GDP.
Because actually, we don't need to wait for them to finish the whole four-year course, right? So it's a skills training. So if you can have
six months
course, right, from when they graduate on their 12th year, then they can take that course and be employed immediately. So and then they can always go back because I think the style of TESDA is they're into lateralized approach. And after you work, you save some money and then you can go back to college if you want, right? But at least the family doesn't have to suffer and borrow money to put you through education 4 years of that, only to end up being underemployed or unemployed, right? So might as well just take a shorter course where there is a great need for that skill. And you're helping yourself, your family, and you're also helping all these companies, the industries that need this valuable skill.
Surprisingly, we found out that college graduates are the ones who take TESDA types of courses.
Really? That's interesting.
It's not the unemployed.
You'll have to come back and talk about this more.
We still have a lot
Bring
more questions.
All of the numbers here. Thank you so much for being here tonight.
Thank you. Thank you very much.